Captain Beefheart and his magic band, Trout Mask Replica. The main thing I'll say is it's really important that when you say the name of these records, it's Captain Beefheart and his magic band. At some point it became the magic band. Like, it wasn't his magic band, it was the magic band. Now, you know, I don't want to go too deep into... Actually, I will get too deep into that. Let's get deep into that. And this is the record to get it deep into how badly Don Van Bleet Captain Beefheart treated his band members. This is the first Captain Beefheart record released on Straight. There were only actually two on Straight. It was this one and then the next one, which is Lick My Decals Off, Baby, another Straight release. And this is the only Captain Beefheart record produced by Frank Zappa. Of all the Captain Beefheart records, this is the one that's enshrined in lore, in legend. All these stories are vast. Nobody knows what's true, what's not. I mean, a lot of the members, Sudhorn Rollo or Drumbo, they've done a lot of, you know, interviews, books, where they basically recall these times. This is the third Captain Beefheart record. After they did Safe as Milk, which was actually episode one of Vinyl Roulette, they were dropped by Buddha Records because even though the 60s were really adventurous, Captain Beefheart was still too strange for the 60s. And I mean, Captain Beefheart is still too strange for modern times, I think. You know, when you play this record to people, they still look at you like something's wrong with you, even though it came out in 1969. After the first record, which was 67, in 68 they released... It was originally going to be called It Comes to You in a Brown Paper Bag, but then it was released as Strictly Personal, which I'll also show you the cover because this is a rare record. It has, you know, the like a box, like somebody shipped this. But anyways, the point is Beefheart was being dropped quickly, like after a single, after a record, by each record label. That was a death sentence. It's still a death sentence, but especially in the 60s, 70s, when a label just drops you after each album, it's basically a death sentence unless you're a huge star, and it's happening because you're moving from label to label. So, you know, they were dropped from A&M after their first single, Didi Wa Didi, and then they were also then dropped by Buddha Records after Safe as Milk, and then by Blue Thumb after Strictly Personal. So then Zappa was a friend of Don Van Bleet. That's the real name of Captain Beefheart. He was a friend of him in the Mojave Desert. They grew up together. And somehow they both ended up being these weird avant-garde musicians in the 60s. I'll get into a little bit of speculation here because, you know, a lot of this is, again, shrouded by legend mystery. But there's a lot of people who believe that Zappa was both in awe and jealous of Beefheart. You know, Beefheart would do effortlessly what Zappa would take hours transcribing, showing his musicians, and then he would be anal about it. It had to be played perfectly. It had to be performed a certain way or else it wasn't this Zappa thing. And then, you know, Zappa is a whole other discussion for me because I think Beefheart is a better musician or whatever the Beefheart and his magic band, the magic band, released. I think ultimately was always a better quality of what Zappa did. And I think it has to do with that. It just came out of Beefheart. Just, he didn't even need to think about it. A lot of people think that Zappa just wanted to see how Van Bleet would tell his band members, you know, hey, play this part, play this part. And don't get me wrong, there was a lot of really specific things then that Captain Beefheart wanted from the musicians that played with him. At the same time, he wasn't a trained musician. He wasn't somebody who could write notation. Everything I've read that I'm gonna say comes from the drummer at this point, Drumbo. He tells about how Beefheart, for this record, would just sit in front of a piano and then just start screaming notes, you know, oh, this is what the bass plays, and like playing stuff on the piano and like filling what he couldn't do with his voice, or just with his voice, or just with the piano, just going back and forth, and this like weird cacophony Drumbo would hear and then had to make sense. So then Drumbo would get his drum parts from Beefheart. You know, he would get the guitar parts, the bass part. Then he would have to teach these parts to the musicians. All the musicians, including Beefheart, from what I understand, lived in a house somewhere in the hills. I think I read it was Laurel Canyon, but I could be wrong about that. But they weren't musicians with money at all. They lived with food stamps. Drumbo would also write about how sometimes they would just eat a can of beans all the members together would eat a can of beans a day. Like, that was their meal for the day. So it was a really harsh environment. And I'm saying all of this because there's so much mysticism that we put into artists, be it music, be it film, be it painting, be it actors. I think that most of the great art comes out of not pain, but like some sort of a subconscious place. Like, I don't think, as much as I'm talking about music, I don't think you can say that you know what a musician intends. And I don't think even the musician knows what he intends. This all is almost like a trance, like a trip. And these musicians were put in this situation almost to augment this trance trip, because they would just practice. After Beefheart would give Jumbo the notes of how these songs went, they would practice for the rest of the day, you know, 12 hours, 8 hours, boom, boom, boom. Let's practice again. Let's see these songs. Okay, now Pachuca Cadaver. Okay, you know, like Moonlight in Vermont. This is a double record. This is the longest Captain Beefheart record. It's just insanity to me that people living on basically a can of beans a day, being given non-musical notes by their, you know, front man. These are the songs. Now learn them. And then they learn them. And then they go to a studio with Zappa and in... I don't remember exactly how long it took, but from what I remember, it wasn't that long. I think it was like 14 days that they recorded everything. In some ways, the worst possible circumstances made this record such a unique piece. And this record, out of all the Captain Beefheart records, is the one that people will probably tell you that it's the masterpiece, that it's the classic, that's the one you need to hear. I actually think this is the last Captain Beefheart record that people should listen to. I mean, I think Safest Milk, Clear Spot, Spotlight Kid, I think those are the places to start. This is, for me, clearly the weirdest. And I don't think this is the best. I think Clear Spot might be the best Beefheart. This is certainly the most out there of the Beefheart records. And this is certainly the most difficult to penetrate, the most difficult to understand. Like, it will take you 5-6 listens before you even hear a melody, a rhythm you can latch onto. It was unfortunate that Dom Bamblyat treated his members that badly, because clearly they were technically brilliant. Sudhorn Rollo, who is one of the slide guitarists, is one of my biggest influences. It's a style of guitar playing that I don't really hear except in Beefheart. It sounds like it's somebody who's not even thinking about what he's playing. It's effortless. And that's what ultimately is the weird thing about this record. It sounds effortless, and it's because these musicians were living this record. And that's not, I'm not saying that's a good thing, you know? This is insanity. It's insanity to live in this record, but these musicians did live there. And Beefheart did come up with the music, you know? Dom Bamblyat did tell Jumbo, this is how I want those songs to go. And even though it was like a weird chaotic thing where he's just screaming like, this is how I want the bass to go. And now follow this and follow that. And now try to piece this that I just said with the guitar that I said later. You know, he would remember the parts when they were in the studio and say like, no, you're not playing it correctly. No, you should do this and you should do that. So Beefheart and Zappa both have this really anal way of looking at how their music should be played. But Beefheart would let his musicians play how they would. Zappa wouldn't let them. Like, Zappa would be such a sterile thing where it's like, no, you need to play it this way, you need to play it this way, no, you're not playing it the way I want it, so do it the way I want it or don't do it. When Captain Beefheart finally came to the studio, because, you know, the musicians have to do the backing track first, and, you know, depending on what type of music you're doing, but generally the backing track is the drums, bass, then the guitars, and finally by the end you do all the overdubs and the voice. When Beefheart went to record his voice, he specifically told Zappa that he didn't want to use headphones. He would just hear the bleed of the speakers from the mixing control room, and that's how he would sing. So there's a lot of songs where you can hear that the way that Captain Beefheart is singing is really off from the music, and it's because of that. He's not even listening to the music, really, when he's singing. He's kind of hearing the muffled sounds of the control room, and then from there he's like, oh, I think it's in this part, and then he'll just start singing. And once he starts singing, there's no way he can really hear what's the song is. And again, like, a lot of this is enveloped in a folklore and like myth. It's really only the musicians that know what happened. In terms of what avant-garde music became, it's clearly a cornerstone. It's clearly a record that showed that, number one, anybody could get, you know, from any point to this type of music. You don't need to come from jazz, you don't need to come from rock and roll, you don't need to come from the blues, and, you know, Beefheart kind of came more from blues rock. You don't need to be classically trained, I guess that's what I should be saying. This is a really important record. If you haven't heard any Captain Beefheart, in episode one, I talk about Safe as Milk. I would listen to Safe as Milk. That's the first Captain Beefheart record. And then I also recommend Clear Spot, which is maybe not as well known. This guy right here. If you have heard Captain Beefheart, then just give Trout Mask Replica a listen with the ears, number one, that Beefheart wasn't even listening to playback when he was, or, you know, just the muffled sounds of the playback in the background, and just the harsh conditions that the musicians had to live in. I think music has changed very little from the 60s, and that's a pity, because this sort of music should be more, in my opinion, accepted and normal. And from 69 till now, put this on in a Walmart and I'll assure you people are going to start screaming like, what the fuck is that? Music hasn't evolved that much, and that's unfortunate. Actually, I should have shown more of the art here on this record. But on a lot of the Captain Beefheart records, this is the rest of the band. You'll have like a few doodles or designs from him, like this. That's a dumb bamboo-lit painting. He, you know, basically became more of a painter, and I'm pretty sure he made much more money selling paintings than he did being a musician. When he died, I was a fan probably for like 7 years, maybe 10, close to 10, but I was barely understanding, and by that I don't mean that I know what they wanted to do, but I was barely understanding what the music that Beefheart did with the Magic Band was capable of. And I feel like I was late to the game, you know, not that I could really do much about it. I wish Captain Beefheart was a well-known name. I wish it was at least as well-known as Zappa. In the discography that they did, you will find blues rock, you will find this sort of extreme avant-garde pastiche that then influenced John Zorn, you know, Fantomas, that sort of music, Melvins, PJ Harvey, Nick Cave with Birthday Party and his Bad Seed stuff, Tom Waits. Like, I can just spew so many musicians. But in the end, I think the world will always have better musicians if this is one of the pillars